So good afternoon, everyone. Just like them, I'm from NUS High School. I'm Jing Xuan, and I graduated last year. So I'm 19 this year. So today, my presentation is about my adventures in building two electromagnetic projectile launchers, a railgun and a coilgun, and yeah, what I learned from it. So firstly, on about electromagnetic projectile launchers. So most of you may have heard of them. There are two main kinds. Firstly, is a railgun. And the different other kind is a coilgun. So even though they're both electromagnetic projectile launchers, their working mechanism is quite different. So the reason why electromagnetic projectile launchers are so great is that they are much faster. The fastest one is currently the US Navy railgun. It has reached speeds of Mach 7, which is several magnitudes above the fastest chemical propulsion gun that we know. And it is much safer, you do not need any fuel, you do not need gunpowder, all you need is electricity and your gun can fire. And lastly, you do not need specialized projectiles or bullets, such as the ones that the US military is using. Each missile can easily cost a few million. Whereas for this, you can essentially shoot any hunk of metal, as long as it can pass a current through or it can be attracted by magnets. So, now on to coilguns and railguns. So the first kind which you might be more familiar with is the coilgun. So as the name suggests, the coilgun consists of the gun itself, the bullet, and a few coils, usually one or two or more if you want. So during operation, you pass a current through the coils, and due to Lenz's law, the inductors then set up a magnetic field, and this attracts the magnetic projectile forwards. So in operation, they actually do this, they switch on the coils in series. So they will switch on the first one, attract the projectile forwards, and then switch on the second one immediately after, and this propels the projectile forwards. It's a simple theory, and it is a very popular gun among electronics enthusiasts. Firstly, it is very easy to build, it is very safe, and there are hundreds of YouTube tutorials on how to build a coil gun. And the second one is the real gun. It is less common, and they work under different principles. So they consist of a pair of rails and a projectile sitting in between. And during operation, you pass a current through one rail to the other, and this current is passed through during the entire process. And the magnetic field is generated according to Bell-Savart law, and so you can see the projectile, there is a current passing through the projectile, and this current is moving in a magnetic field. So the projectile then experiences the Lenz's law, which propels the projectile forwards. So all you need is to just pump current through the entire thing, and the bullet will propel itself. So railguns are much faster, such as like you can see the military likes them because they can go up to Mach 5 and above. And they are mechanically very simple. All you need is, they are sometimes called the brute force guns, because all you need is to just pump current into them and they will go as fast as you can. And they are very popular now due to the US Navy railgun and the China Navy railgun. So I think the US Navy one has, you haven't heard much about it recently, but the Chinese Navy one has been mounted. And I think it's operational. So, however, why are we not seeing these projectile launchers everywhere despite their obvious benefits? So the main thing is it is extremely inefficient. So the typical chemical propulsion guns, they have efficiency of maybe about 40% or so. Real guns, the highest one is about 10 to 20%. So this is the main problem. And other than the high inefficiency, there are other challenges that both guns face. So the first one is the coilgun, as many DIY YouTubers have found out that this is the current profile you need when you are shooting a coilgun. So you need two current spikes to propel it forward. And the problem comes in deciding when do I generate these current spikes, and secondly, in generating the high current spikes itself. Whereas for railgun, and this is the main problem that the US Navy is facing, so when we pass the current through it, it's usually upwards of millions of amperes for the fully functional railgun, and the projectile has to touch the conductive rails in order for the current to move through it. So as you can expect, this operates at very high temperatures, and as it goes through, the rails start getting damaged, and eventually it stops touching the bullet, and the whole gun cannot work anymore. You have to replace the rails, which are usually very expensive. And this was the main problem that the US Navy faced. So, other than the damage faced by the rails, the second problem is that you need to sustain a high current pulse during the entire time the projectile is moving through the rails. So now I'll be talking about how I constructed my railgun. So why do I do it? Because railguns are cool. So the first problem we had to solve is the problem with rail damage. And so we decided that we would add a gap between the projectile and the rails. So we created a gap, and then we decided to bridge the gap using a plasma arc, as this will allow current to continue passing from the rails through the projectiles to the other rail. So this was my ball design. As you can see, the bullet is inside the railgun right now, and the bullet is actually not contacting the rails at all. And these are the copper rails, and this is a Teflon guide, more about that later, and the whole gun is inside a G10 casing to hold everything strongly. So this was my specialized bullet. So unfortunately we had to design our own bullet this time because we had to concentrate the electric field at the side. Because it is not touching the rails, we had to ensure that the gas in between can actually break down to form the plasma arc. And by having these pointed edges, it will allow the formation of plasma arc to happen more easily. So this is how it looks like from the top. So those are the rails, and these are the Teflon guides, and you can see the grooves and glides, and the bullet fits perfectly onto the guides, and it guides the bullet forward in a straight line. So in order to have our plasma arc, because air breaks down at a very high voltage, and we do not want to work with that high voltage, so instead we flush helium gas into the space between the bullet and the rails to allow arcing to occur at lower voltages. So the gap was about 0.5 mm, and here we have the video of it. We are flushing helium gas through it. You can see the plasma. Okay, so first we have solved the issue because now the bullet no longer touches the rails. However, the second problem we had was we had to sustain the high current. Typically, capacitors discharge in an exponential decay form, whereas what we needed was this flat top current output waveform. So we found a solution to that, which is a power formation network, which is a network of capacitors and inductors. So how do they work? So imagine this is your PLN, and firstly you charge up your capacitors. And when you want to shoot your gun, you have to discharge your capacitor. But instead of discharging it directly into the rail, you discharge it through an inductor. And given the properties of inductors, they want to resist changes in current. And some of this energy is then converted to magnetic fields, and a smaller current is passed out from the inductor instead. Afterwards, when the capacitor has fully discharged, as the capacitor drops, and then the inductor will then convert its magnetic field back into current. And so this sustains the current for a longer period of time compared to if we just discharge the capacitor. So in order to build our PFN for our specialized gun, we had to we ran multiple circuit simulations in a LT-SPICE-4, and then we constructed our own circuit. So we used capacitors, and then our inductors are constructed at about 800 microfarads. So we had to coil our own inductors and measure the diameter and how many turns we needed and everything. So they are about the size of toilet rolls. So this was the result of our third event. So even though our simulation worked, we had to revise the actual constructed circuit multiple times before we managed to get one that was similar to the simulation. So we ran it about recharge capacitors to 1 kV, and then we discharged them into the real gun and used an oscilloscope to measure the current. So this was the actual current waveform we obtained, which is the peak is about 1 kA, and this was sustained for 200 milliseconds. So we decided that this was good enough for our real gun, and we were finally ready to fire it. So this is the video. The fireworks are some of the vaporized aluminium from the bullet because it's at very high temperatures. So this was some data. So we charged our capacitors, four of them wanted it to have three curves, and I wanted it to operate at 180 volts, and lastly, I wanted it to be portable so I can bring it everywhere and fire everything. Okay. So, as mentioned earlier, a coilgun has very different challenges. Firstly, you have to switch the coils on and off at very accurate timings, so you have to see the projectile, and secondly, the easier solution would be to use an Arduino to turn the coils on and off, and then it comes to the second problem. Your Arduino was at 5 volts, my capacitor is 180 volts. I need to somehow switch the capacitor with an Arduino, and secondly, I have the portability issue. So, I do not want to have to plug my coilgun into a wall socket to use it, so I have to use a LiPo machine, and I want to set 7.4 volts. I needed to set it up to 180 volts to charge my capacitors. So, to set up a bridge, we managed to find this inverter from China, and it sets up 4.7 volts DC into 150 volts AC. So, very interesting, this one we couldn't actually find the data sheet for it, we had to just probe the thing, and before we found 150 volts. So, it worked very well, it produced 150 volts AC square wave, but our capacitors are electrolytic, and so we needed to build our own full bridge rectifier to convert the 150 volt AC into 150 volt DC. So this is how our full bridge rectifier works, and so we were able to obtain our 150 volts DC to charge our capacitors with. So now next is the switching circuit. So as mentioned earlier, our capacitor is at 150 volts, our Arduino will die if you hit it with more than 20 volts. So we have to isolate our Arduino from the rest of the high power circuit. And the easiest way to do that was to use a photo relay. So a photo relay is a very useful component. It's a package with both a diode and a light activated switch. So when the Arduino turns on the LED, it will then close the switch. So very simple. So however, the photo relay cannot withstand a very high current pulse to the capacitor. So we have to use another switch, in this case a MOSFET. The reason why we couldn't switch the MOSFET directly with the Arduino is that when you use a MOSFET, the ground of whatever your MOSFET is switching has to share a ground with the Arduino. So when we did that, the Arduino explodes, you get a lot of very nice smoke. So this is our full switching circuit. Firstly, the Arduino, it triggers the photo relay. So this is where the Arduino signal comes in. And the photo relay then triggers the MOSFET, and the MOSFET allows the capacitor to discharge into the coils. So this is a very fast process actually. And afterwards, we needed to see the projectile in order to decide when to turn on the coils. So we use an IR sensor instead of a light gate. We found this much easier to use. So an IR sensor can detect the object in front, so it makes up of a bulb and a sensor, and when the object passes in front of the bulb, it will reflect the light from the IR bulb into the sensor. So this can help us see the projectile. And then so this was a call, three stages, and we tried to count the number of turns, but then we lost count. So we just knees and almost picking up 6 kilowatts on the floor. High power is scary. And the second thing I learned is that even though through my presentation it seemed that everything worked very well, there were actually a lot of damages. My railgun was very destructive in all the wrong ways. We blew up a 3K signal generator the first thing when we tried to fire it the first time. And it proceeded to blow up 5 more Arduinos. And so what I learned is that everything doesn't go well. It never goes well. Things will explode, things will break. But however, the most important thing is that you must be able to find out what went wrong, fix the issue, and build and try again. And you have to iterate over many cycles before you can finally have a working product. So that's my experience. And for the future of electromagnetic launchers, so even though many people think guns are bad, guns cause war, they kill people, however, they are called guns, they are first and foremost electromagnetic launchers. So the most exciting thing it can do right now is firstly, it can possibly launch satellites into low Earth orbit. So we all know about the SpaceX reusable rockets, right? That's a relatively new thing. And so if we had an EM launcher, we would completely negate the need for having a rocket to bring small satellites into space. In fact, we can just shoot them into space from Earth using a railgun. And secondly, it is a very useful way to do certain kinds of fusion because it is a projectile launcher. It can launch anything. It can launch air. It can launch particles. So it is currently being studied to use to launch certain kinds of objects to cause fusion. And lastly, it can allow people to simulate many different kinds of, space phenomena such as solar winds and things like that, which we are not able to simulate in our labs right now because the air moves at too high, we need to launch things at too high a speed that is feasible for us. But with railguns and coilguns, we can possibly allow that to happen in the near future. So, thank you. Any questions? Similarly, with the submarine group, we will have a booth at the downstairs, so if you want, you can come and see my railgun and coilgun later. Thank you.